The next keynote would be by Daisy Chittilapilly. She's the Managing Director, Digital Transformation Office of Cisco, India and SAARC. Daisy leads the Digital Transformation Office for Cisco, India and SAARC in her current role. She drives Cisco's digital transformation agenda, aligning Cisco's offerings and ecosystems to emerging opportunities in digital India, and leads the charge in digitally enabling organizations across sectors and industries in India. In her previous role, Daisy led the Cisco India and SAARC partner organizations to success by building new ecosystems and programs that help Cisco and the partners grow profitably, resulting in Cisco's India's having one of the best partner programs in the industry. She was instrumental in developing new approaches to capture important market transitions, strengthening relationships with some of the most important partners, and building an ecosystem of new partners throughout India and SAARC region. I would request Daisy to come on stage and give us the keynote.
Good morning. I think Prakash has done an excellent job of setting up the day for today, and it's always difficult to follow Prakash if you have heard him speak before. So let me see what the discussion can be about today. So we live in interesting times, right? Everything we know is getting reorganized. If we look at the society we are living in, so we live in an age of reorganization, and everything we know is getting reorganized. So if, as human beings, we are at an age where being connected, being always on, is at a degree where it has never been for us before. We don't think anything today about augmenting our IQ with external help. Think Google Search, think Alexa, think Google Home. We are more open to sharing resources and capabilities than we were ever before. So there's a degree of reorganization within human beings and the societies we live in. If you look at businesses, they are either being powered by or disrupted by the subscription economy. So we're moving from an era of ownership to one of consumption. We are moving from an era of mass appeal to an era of hyper-personalization. So the way that a car or a cell phone or a garment is sold to me versus sold to you has to be very different today. And probably we are, which is the most interesting thing for a lot of you in this room, the entry barrier for challenges is at the lowest that it has ever been in the world. And in governments, it is the reemergence of the national identity, with governments putting out programs to improve competitiveness. Think Digital India, think demonetization, think cashless societies, etc. If there's one thing that is driving this reorganization across societies, businesses, and governments, it is technology. And it is this technology-led intervention of the way that we all work, live, play, and learn that we refer to very often as digital, digitalization or digitization. And depending on who you are, your digital interventions can have different focuses. If you come from a very customer service industry, then customer experience is probably at the core of all your digital efforts. If you are a knowledge worker or a labor-intensive company, then the workforce is where your digital interventions and technology interventions are centered today. If you're a government, citizen experience and citizen services is where your focus is going to be. And if you are a physical assets company, think manufacturing, then you know, most of your work that you do in digital and you do with technology is going to be centered around physical assets. Digital is also made possible by the coming together of a number of technologies, coming together of age of a number of technologies all at the same time. You think cloud, which has more or less become mainstream and well understood today, artificial intelligence, blockchain, and maybe the one that is center stage for the day today, Internet of Things or IoT. The value of IoT is now well understood. This is a journey to IoT value conversation that Cisco had with a client set of ours which is worldwide, and it is no longer about whether IoT can deliver value. 73% of all of our clients that we talk to have some IoT intervention related to an outcome conversation, related to an extraction of value conversation going on in their enterprise. And the use cases of value are all the way from customer acquisition and experience to product quality, to reducing downtime, to reducing risk, to making workforces more efficient. So it's no longer an if about, you know, because IoT is a maturing, it's still a maturing space. But there are a number of use cases now in the industry which are quantifying the value of IoT. So it's no longer a question of should we as an enterprise, or if you are a startup working in this space or a technology provider, look at IoT as a space to create value or extract value. So companies obviously want to derive value from data, specifically IoT data, and focus on IoT data for the day because that's where we are focused today. But IoT data comes with its own set of challenges, right? It's an exponential increase in data. And we as a world are still wrapping our heads and arms around what the definition of exponential means. To give you a data point, many years ago we said that 50 million things will connect to the internet by 2020. And now we'll have to revise that forecast at the rate we are going. As Cisco, we connected more things than information technology devices to the internet last year. So the pace at which things are getting connected is increasing. That's no longer in question today. But the types of data that's bringing in forward is, and the amount of data it's bringing forward is what everybody who's working in the IoT space and the space of IoT value has to grapple with. So it's fairly basic, right? You connect a bunch of things, extract data, move that to a bunch of applications, and run some analytics, run some improvement metrics on it. That's easily said than done. It's like a one, it's very easy to put it up on a slide. To make things a bit more interesting, even in a single enterprise, these things and applications are very often dispersed all over the world. They are even dispersed beyond the boundaries of an enterprise. So it is truly becoming a boundaryless world. So earlier, the only boundaryless device that we talked about was the smartphone. The way to think about the IoT edge is a lot like we think about the smartphone. So it is any place, anywhere, any device. So the same terminologies have to apply in the IoT construct as well. So enterprises clearly are challenged. The first challenge is you have to connect things that have never been connected before. You have to manage these connected things. And then there is this overarching concern about security. So first, things which have never been connected have to be connected, but they have to be connected securely, and then they have to be managed as well. The second is data, the types of data conversation that I mentioned earlier, right? There's different kinds of data coming out from different devices that have never before spoken to each other. So it's a fairly siloed data universe. So how do you bring data sources together that have never before been aggregated? The third piece is there's no framework today that exists, or frameworks are emerging. As a company and as a provider in this space, you have to think about how to move data from all these sources to applications which can make sense of that data, can get insights, and can automate some actions. So that's the third big thing to think about. And the fourth is this overarching conversation, which is now very much in the public domain in India, around privacy, data sovereignty, who owns the data, who owns the IP that comes out of, you know, extracting value from that data. So there are all these conversations about data and IP ownership and usage. So as Cisco, right, and I think as any, and I think Prakash also referred to, I mean, I was listening to him from when I was outside, a little bit of this Prakash also, so you will see resonating messages come to you from various speakers today. But let me talk about the five things that we recommend anybody who's working in this space to look at. Whether you are an enterprise wanting to go down the path of extracting value, or you are a provider aiming to give value to an enterprise in IoT. The first is the question of connectivity. We are in an age of amazing connectivity today, but like I said, the complication of this world is you are talking about a set of devices that have never been connected before. So your construct of networks, all pervasive networks, has to extend to the OT universe, the operational technology universe. Your frameworks have to start thinking about IT plus OT. So it's not just you, we are also thinking about this world. So you no longer can do things the way more things, I mentioned earlier that more things are connecting, millions of things are connecting at speed. So the way we managed networks earlier, which was all about, you know, so far, we have managed networks through manual interventions. So we go in, we, you know, we control what devices get connected, we have a high degree of manual intervention in building and managing networks. The world of things is not a world that we can manage that way because millions of things which are not always visible to you are connecting by the minute into the networks that you are managing. So you need a more intuitive, automated way of allowing devices to connect, making sure that devices that connect have the right level of access and policy control so they don't go, you know, a server has a certain set of rights, but a temperature sensor shouldn't. Or a machine, IoT machine shouldn't, or a traffic light shouldn't, right? So you have to make sure that you are able to manage this universe of things in a way that is intuitive, automated, and least human intervention, and therefore least human error. Right? That's the first piece of consideration. The second thing, let's say you get over this. The second problem you'll have is one of data overload, for sure, because you have different types of data and you have an amount of data. So this is where your considerations about what data to deal with at the edge is very important, and this is where conversations around edge computing, fog computing, and so on. So all your frameworks related to what to do with data where has to be very, very clear. I also urge you to think about, in this context, about a data fabric, because you do need a place to aggregate data to, standardize different types of data, compute data, and move data to where its eventual home is. So you have to think about edge computing. You also have to think about what the data fabric for an enterprise is going to be if you are an enterprise, or how do you integrate whatever use case you have into the data fabric of an enterprise to whom you are providing value, if you are a supplier of technology or IoT technology into that space. The third is, not all data will reside at the edge, not all data will reside in your data center, because we do have this incredible powerful tool called the cloud. So the world will actually decide, as an enterprise will decide, which workload and which application is best suited to deal with at the edge, which should be dealt with in their data center, and which should be dealt with in the cloud. So as an enterprise, and even as a provider, you have to think about a workload's ideal home. And that's why having a very clear multi-cloud strategy and the ability to move data and applications between these various points of presence and move it back and forth as the requirements change is a necessary consideration. And so that is obviously a part, because you can't think about IoT edge without thinking about what to do with the data and what to do with the application after that. And because on top of that comes your insights and your actions, which is what an enterprise really needs. And the fourth is, I mentioned this earlier in the context of data sovereignty and privacy, but this is a world where it is not a question of if you will get attacked, it is only a question of when you will get attacked. And I think we have plenty of public cases which are unfortunate, which we all know and talk about, where the hacks have come from the IoT world, not come from the IT world. Here again, the paradigm needs to shift. We have traditionally thought about security and cybersecurity in the context of information technology. And it's important to now develop a framework, language policies which cover both the information technology world and the operational technology world. So you have to rethink your frameworks for security, cybersecurity in particular, and sometimes, depending on the process, even include aspects of physical security on the process side. So the way you think about security is IT plus OT plus physical. If you really have to get value out of an IoT use case and securely derive value out of an IoT use case. And the last but not the least is mostly people are doing this for two or three reasons. They are trying to drive immersive experiences for their customers. They're trying to drive immersive experiences for their employees. These are the two reasons. Ultimately, our, you know, as an enterprise, how you present yourself outside is what is deciding your competitiveness. Gartner put out a study saying that customer experience is the single factor on which companies will compete with each other. So everything that you do ultimately is measured by the improvement in experience of your customer, whether that's your internal customer, who's your employee, or an external customer of yours. That's you and me of a consumer brand as an example. So five real, you know, there are five big things to think about from a technology piece when you look at the world of IoT, not just look at the edge. But don't lose sight of the outcome. Because in the IoT world, it is no longer, in the technology world also, it is no longer about technology for technology's sake, it is an outcome economy world. So I put up examples of outcomes that are today being driven in a specific industry, which is manufacturing, because manufacturing is the place where we are seeing the earliest use cases and proof points of value coming out. We are seeing it also in cities. In India, we're also seeing it. At Cisco, we're also seeing it in cities. But I put out manufacturing because a lot of the use cases also are fungible between multiple industries. So if you're a player who is providing value in IoT, think about use cases that are fungible. The vocabulary will change, but the customer, with a certain minimal amount of customization, there are multiple fungible use cases from one industry to another. And like I said, this is not anymore a question which is limited to an academic discussion. Proof points of value are emerging from the largest names in the world. Some of them have a presence in India as well. So proof points are obviously around, you know, there are numbers around reducing disruptions for customers. There are numbers around cycle time reductions. There are numbers around vulnerabilities being reduced. So these proof points of value are fairly public and more are emerging. I think in the next 12 months, even as, you know, from an Indian context, you will start to see India-centric, India GDP, domestic companies land up on slides like this, because the early IoT implementations in the country which are outcome focused are already underway. As Cisco, we're already working with an FMCG major, a mining company, and a couple of banks to actually put out proof points. And if I was talking to you 90 days from today, I would have had a bunch of very, very Indian names to put out here. Unfortunately, the timing is such, but I'm happy to talk to you offline on what we are doing. It's good to be focused on, you know, today where we are is we are focused on one particular use case and very specific outcomes. But I think one other consideration is to think about where is the value chain within the enterprise and how does value translate across the multiple silos of your enterprise. So IoT is not something, if I was to look at manufacturing again, coming back to that industry as an example, a lot of the use cases are, when you think IoT, you think plant. And that's also where the early proof points and the early outcomes are coming out. But it is also a value that can translate all the way from the plant to what you do in the HQ, into your distribution chain, into your workforce, and so on. So it's important while you're working on the early use cases and proof points of value to also think about how the value exchange will be at an enterprise level and how it will be between multiple departments in your enterprise or in an enterprise, if you're looking at an enterprise from outside. Because very often, the true power of any new technology is if you can get disparate systems to collaborate with each other and bring out newer outcomes for the enterprise as a whole. So as an example, it has never been possible, even in the biggest manufacturers in the country, as an example, a central HQ manager cannot see what the parameters of all their plants are today. Most cannot. It's very, very rudimentary and very, very basic. So while you're looking at IoT use cases which improve the plant efficiency, as an example, you also can think about how that can materially change decision-making capability of the manager of that plant or the management of that company who's many kilometers and miles away from that plant. So think about the value exchange not just within the use case you're looking at, but what else it can impact in other divisions or departments of an enterprise. And to an enterprise also, we say the same thing, is while we focus on early use cases, to think about what your blueprint is going to be from IoT or for IoT to extract value cross-enterprise across all the pieces of your operations. The last thing I want to leave today is, we said this many years ago, we continue to say this, but I think it's a point that has still not been driven home. IoT is not a battle that can be fought alone. Managing an outcome very often calls for inter-collaboration at a scale, level, and nature that the industry, especially the technology industry, has not been used to. For customers also, it's a new way of doing things, because you have to talk to multiple players, all playing together like a team, to give out an outcome which may not be even visible to the first player or some of the players on that team. As Cisco, and you know, because I know a lot of you are startups, I do want to call out an opportunity here to engage with us. This is, like I said, a space where the entry barriers are at its lowest for anyone who has an interesting use case. So the position that industry players like Intel, and Prakash mentioned it before me, and what even we at Cisco are doing, is try to bring together ecosystems to create greater meaning for the industry and greater value for enterprises. So please be open to approaching anybody in this space if you have a story to tell and if you have a use case that is of value to an enterprise. Thank you for your attention. I wish us all a great day today.
I would welcome Venki Kumaran, our co-chair and senior director of ARM, to come in and give a moment to Daisy. So, fantastic presentation from Daisy, the marriage of OT and IT. It's all about the ecosystem. It's not just technology, it's a business case as well to convince an entire enterprise and the importance of the ecosystem.